speaker of the day is Sandra, and she will talk about excellence.
It's a pleasure to be here. Today I'm going to talk about, two topics in one, and they are very related, which is why I put them together. So the first is adaptive inference, and then its application, so to say, to adaptivity in X-arm bandits, where here X-arm bandits are basically bandits on continuous space. So this is based on several joint works, in fact, with several people. First, Olga Klopp, who is in Paris, Samuel Potoufé, who is in Princeton, Andrea Locatelli, who is in Magdeburg with me, Mathias Loeffler and Richard Nickel, who are in Cambridge. So the bandit part of the talk first, quickly to explain what we want to do. So we are interested in non-convex optimization. The objective here would be to, so we have an unknown function, we observe it in noise, and we can choose several places where we sample the function. So what we want to do is to either find or exploit the maximum NF of the unknown function F. So find this classical optimization, and exploit is more related to the bandit cumulative regret, where we want to, so to say, sample as much as possible the maximum. So here, the question to which I'm going to be interested in, because this problem has been tackled quite a lot in the past years, is to design algorithms that adapt to the difficulty of the problem. So morally, the idea is that you have a function, and it can be the problem of optimization or exploitation, so to say, can be more or less complicated depending on the function. And so what we want to do is to see whether it's possible or not to adapt to the difficulty of the problem. I will explain a little bit later what I mean by that. So morally, adapting to the difficulty of the problem, what I mean is, so to say, that if you have a function that is very smooth, very nice, it should be easier than for a function where you have a lot of like minimas which are close to each other and which is very unsmooth. And so we would like to try to adapt to such differences. The rate should be different in these two problems. Another way to formulate the question, which is maybe the way it's usually done, is to ask whether one can adapt to the hyperparameters of the problem. So for instance, here, the smoothness of the functions. So in this talk, as mentioned, I will talk about two topics which are very related, but not at first sight, let's say. So the first one is adaptive inference in statistics. Adaptive inference in statistics, what it is basically trying to build estimators and confidence sets that adapt to the complexity of the model, so to say. And then we are going to see morally how these things has impacts in continuously armed bandits. And what we can say then regarding adaptivity in continuously armed bandits and why it's related morally to adaptive inference. So I will first start with adaptive inference. So as a motivation, let's consider regression. And you can think really of the most simple setting that you know. So you, you want to estimate a function given some data, some noisy data. And what you want to do more precisely is not just estimation, but what is called inference. That is to say estimation and uncertainty quantification or confidence sets for the function. So you can think of the problem as follows. You have a function f, which is defined on 0, 1 to the d, for instance. You have n observed data samples, and the n data samples are noisy observation of f in point xi, where the xi, let's say, are uniform, to simplify everything. And here, epsilon is a noise. So epsilon, let's say, is independent, centered, and bounded. You can assume sub-Gaussian if you want. It doesn't really make a difference. Here, we want to do inference in this setting. And of course, it's impossible in all generality, or rather, it's possible, but the bounds are trivial. And so in order for this problem to be interesting, one needs to put some structure on the function f. And the typical thing to do is to assume smoothness. So we are going to consider some space of parameters, C alpha, which will be Hölder balls of parameter alpha. So for instance, for S smaller than 1, a Hölder ball is simply the set of function F that satisfy for all x and y this inequality, which is to say that these functions are smooth in every point. And so we are going to be interested in inference over this set C of F. Is it clear? Is everything clear? Yeah?
Is the last, second to last line, this would one? That be alpha less than or equal to 1?
Sorry. Yes, yes. Thank you. OK. So here, I'm going not only to be interested in inference, as mentioned, but adaptive inference. And the question of adaptive inference can be casted in a non-technical way as follows. So if F is in C of alpha, the optimal precision of inference should depend on alpha. And morally, if you know alpha, then you can, I mean, you could easily, so to say, do something. And the problem is, what do you do when you don't know alpha? Is it still possible to have inference with precision that depends on alpha if you don't know alpha? So adaptive inference is, in fact, one of the central questions of statistics. And it has been really studied quite heavily in the last 50 years or so. So I'm here going to give a very brief explanation of the flavor of the result in adaptive inference. So let's now go to a more general model, because it doesn't really matter, in fact, what is the model that I assumed. So let's assume that you have two large sets, C0 and C1, and that for any element f in C1, we associate a probability distribution. So if you want, f is a parameter. For instance, in the previous example, you can use f, the function itself, as a parameter. And then the distribution pf is just the distribution of x and y. And then you receive a data set of NIID entries according to pf. And you want to try to do adaptive inference on f. So what does it mean in this context, adaptive inference? So this very simplified context, so to say. You have two sets, C0 and C1. C0 is smaller than C1. And you want to try to do estimation, confidence sets, adaptively to C0 and C1. So morally, since C0 is smaller than C1, you should be able to do more precise inference in C0 than in C1. And so the question is whether it is possible to adapt to that if you don't know whether you are in C0 or in C1. So this is, in a very simplified way, the question of adaptive inference. Is it all clear? So I will give now the mathematical explanation a little bit. So estimation, first let me define minimax optimal estimation. It's what I will be interested here. So the minimax optimal estimation error over the model H is simply the infimum over all possible estimators of the supremum over all possible problems in CH of the distance of the estimator and the true function, according to model F. So we are going to call this RH, so R0 for the smaller model, and R1 for the larger model. And since C0 is included in C1, morally, R0 is always smaller than R1. This is clear. So for instance, let's go back to the example I introduced in the beginning. Let's say that we want to estimate the function F in L infinity norm. So you want to estimate really the function F in every point. What you can prove is that over the Hölder ball of radius alpha, of parameter alpha, sorry, the rate of the minimax rate of estimation is this one. So log n over n to the alpha over 2 alpha plus t. So it's a classical non-parametric rate of estimation over Hölder balls. The square here, and whenever I have a square, it means constant. The constant here depends on alpha and e. So, okay. So this is the minimax optimal rate. It's known since very long time. And now, adaptive inference, what it means is to try to adapt to that when you don't know alpha. So this is achievable typically with algorithms that know alpha. So morally, the idea, for instance, is that you project on a basis your data, and you threshold some elements of your basis, and the smaller alpha, the more elements you need to keep. So this is why it depends on alpha. To do that, you need to know alpha.
Just a question. So in this particular example, what would be your C0 and C1?
So you can take, yes, very good question. Sorry, I didn't mention. So for instance, C1, it would be for a given gamma, for a given alpha, and C0 for gamma. So you have two, so to say, sets. And here, I just take two models. In fact, you have a continuum, but in order to cast the problem in a simple way, I just take two. And morally, if we can adapt to two, we can adapt to the continuum. It's not completely intuitive, but it's often like that. Yeah. So this is a minimax estimation. So as mentioned, morally, since C0 is smaller than C1, so for instance, so to answer the question, in C0 you have a smoothness gamma, which is much larger than alpha in C1, and so you have a function f which is very smooth. You want to approximate it at a rate R0, and in C1 you want to approximate at rate R1. Typically, the error will be larger here than there. So now adaptive estimation, as mentioned, you want to adapt to the alpha without knowing it. So you want to be able there to find an estimator f hat that doesn't depend on alpha, and that nevertheless will be able to reach the right rate. So here is a definition, like shortened, of adaptive estimation. It's an estimator f hat that now doesn't depend on alpha. So it's the same both in C0 and C1. You don't need to know where you are, such that you get the right rate up to a constant that depends only, so to say, on the parameters, like that depend on nothing here, and such that you have the right rate. Okay? So it's the same as before, only here you want to have an estimator that doesn't need, so to say, to know whether you are in C0 or C1, or to know the smoothness alpha in order to adapt. So now, does it exist for our problem, for instance, of functional estimation? So since a very long time, it's known that it does exist. And in fact, they are not very complicated to construct. You have a lot of ways to construct them, like model selection, Lepsky's method, cross-validation. Everything works, morally, for this problem. It's not something that is very sensitive. Is it okay? So the idea, for those who are not very familiar with adaptation, the idea of such methods for adaptation is that, for instance, for Lepsky's method, you construct an estimator in C0, you construct the estimator in C1, and you see whether this estimator coincides, that is to say, whether the estimator in C0 is at a small distance of the estimator in C1. If it's the case, you take the estimator in C0. If not, you take the one in C1. Yes?
Yeah, like you explained that maybe considering the binary case when you have two things to choose from is the simplest, and you kind of the more complicated case to this. Is it pretty true? For example, if you have a multi-index set like it's alpha has its like it's multi-dimensional, and right? I can imagine cases that maybe there is a multi-dot price attached to you looking at many of these things, right?
You can construct example where there is a price, but okay. In most classical
statistical, I'm just asking, I guess, whether there is really a price, and then whether people understand what is the price if you have many, many things to choose from.
Yeah. So it depends. In fact, sometimes, so there are many works on finding the price of adaptation. In some contexts, the price is zero. It's the case in this setting. In some contexts, you pay a low price. It's often the case. And sometimes, it's even impossible, but this is very rare.
So what price is log n?
Log n price, yeah. So typically, if instead of the L infinity norm, you had like something else.
And if you say it's a log price, do you mean in the asymptotic way, if you're paying a log price, or is it a finite time minimum?
So what do you mean by asymptotic? We had a discussion this morning about asymptotics. What do you mean by asymptotics?
It's like the taking the lean soup of like the right-hand side divided by the left-hand side. Right-hand side smaller than the constant, that's like the asymptotically, this inequality is true. I would say that, right? Yeah. And that's the asymptotic bit. And
so it's always sup over the set.
No. So there is n, the number of observations, mm-hmm. goes to infinity, And this inequality is satisfied in the limit as n goes to infinite. So that would be the asymptotic limit, and then the finite one would be that for every n, there's a constant that works for every n.
So
it's a bit different.
Here, like, since it's a sup over your model, then you say, okay, for n larger than n zero, then you have that. And so, I mean, I don't know if you would call it asymptotic or I mean,
okay.
It depends on. So the correct statement here, like the full statement, would be like for n larger than a constant n zero. So if
how big is that?
It depends only on it depends on alpha.
That's
alpha. And so for
that
this.
Is
if you want.
No. Okay.
I mean, I don't know.
It's a different thing. Okay. Yeah. Good.
So, yeah, I mean, what I mean is that if you, for instance, if you say alpha is in an interval, then you have an absolute constant. That depends on the bound.
But I assume that the threshold goes to infinity as alpha approaches some number. And,
so
like there are more difficult, like less smooth.
If alpha goes to zero, then the constant blows up in this case. But if you say, okay, alpha is between, I don't know, some c larger than zero and infinity, then it's fine.
Okay.
But indeed, you cannot go to alpha equals zero. But alpha equals zero, it doesn't really mean anything anymore. It's really noise.
You know, like when you don't know alpha, maybe it's smaller than like you see the smallest value.
Yeah. But if alpha is too small, anyway, your rates become trivial. Okay, so adaptive estimation. So it's basically when you get something like that. So typically here you just have two classes. Of course, then it's interesting to go over the continuum. For the moment, I won't talk about that because it doesn't really change anything morally. What is interesting here is that in the functional estimation problem, adaptive estimators exist.
Okay.
So it's an old result. It's not mine. Okay, so this is adaptive estimation. Now, quickly, I will talk about the other part of inference, which is confidence sets. And here, I will be interested in adaptive and honest confidence sets, which is also an old concept of adaptive inference. So, morally, what do we want to do? You have C0 and C1. In C0, you have smooth function. In C1, you have rougher functions. As mentioned, the rate of estimation R0 is smaller in C0 than in C1. C1, you have R1. We have seen, for instance, that in the functional estimation problem, you have adaptive estimators, so estimators that adapt to C0 or C1 without knowing if you are in C0 or C1. So here, I try to do that. And the equivalent for adaptive confidence sets would be to do the same for adaptive confidence sets, that is to say, to do confidence sets such that they contain the true parameter with high probability, and such that the diameter is of order RH if F is in CH. So it's the same as adaptive estimation, but for uncertainty quantification, so to say. So formally, such adaptive confidence sets can be mathematically formalized. So here it's a bit edulcorated, but it can be mathematically formalized like that. First, honesty. So you want that for any f in C1, f is in C hat with high probability. This is the first thing. And second thing, adaptivity. So what I meant before, that the diameter of C hat, the confidence set, is of order RH if f is in CH, or smaller than RH if f is in CH. Is it clear for adaptive confidence sets? Okay. This is what we want to do. Now, this is a complicated, so this looks like a complicated problem like that. Or maybe not, maybe you already know what to do, but like that, this looks like a complicated problem. But in fact, it's not so much. In order to see why it's not complicated, I will tell you how to solve this quickly. So you have C0 and C1, and morally, if you knew whether f is in C0 or in C1, you could do adaptive confidence sets. I mean, it would just be taking diameter R0 if you are in C0 and R1 if you are in R1. So like a related problem to the problem of adaptive confidence sets is to test whether F is in C0 or whether F is not in C0. So you want to test this against that. And if you are able to do a perfect test, of course, you are able to do confidence sets. Now the problem, of course, is that you are never able to do a perfect test in the sense that you are never able, if C1 and C0 touch, so to say, to do a test such that uniformly the error is bounded. So uniformly consistent test is a test such that the worst case type 1 error plus the worst case type 2 error is bounded by something arbitrary. So here I choose alpha, you can choose anything. And so, of course, I've mentioned if C0 and C1 touch, this is impossible because you can have points which are arbitrarily close to C0 and you are never going to know whether they are in C0 or in C1, clearly. And so for this reason, and even if this problem is a little bit different than what we want to do for confidence sets, we will see later that this is related. When people talk about composite testing, people typically will consider such tests, where instead of testing C0 versus C1 minus C0, one tests C0 versus F in C1, and the distance between F and C0 is larger than 1, where the distance is, for instance, the same as the one in your adaptive estimation. So if rho is large enough, there will be a test at some point. And so one of the main questions in composite testing, like in uniform testing, is then to determine the minimax order of rho that enables the existence of such a uniform test. So the question can be asked in these terms: what is the smallest rho such that a non-trivial test exists? So why is it related to confidence sets, this story? So let's say that you have this minimax optimal rho, such that for this rho, then you have a test like that. So there was a theorem in Hoffman and Nickel in 2010, but really I think the idea was already around before, which says that if for rho larger than some constant times the rate in C0, there exists no consistent test, then there exists no confidence set. Why that? Because morally, if there exists such a test, then if there existed confidence sets, then you could build a test, right? Because if you have confidence tests, then if you are in C1, like in H1. Then the diameter of the test is of the set. The diameter of the ball around the point is smaller than the separation rate, and so you could do a test. So, if you have, it's not very difficult to prove this. And so, if you have that, so if rho is larger than the rate of estimation in the smallest of the two hypotheses, then you cannot test. You cannot have confidence. Is it okay? So with co-authors, we proved formally a corollary. So again, I think the idea was kind of around before, but it was never formalized and systematized. And so you can prove something which looks like the converse of what was shown before. So now if rho is smaller than a constant time R0, if there exists for this rho a uniform test, and also, if you have an oracle estimator, morally, an oracle estimator is kind of the same as an adaptive estimator, it's a little bit more, then you can construct a confidence set. So you have, morally, what you want. So in order to know if you have confidence set, then what do you need to do? You need to compare rho star, so the rate of testing, with the rate of estimation in C0. If the rate of testing is smaller than the rate of estimation in C0, you have confidence sets, and if not, you don't have confidence. So it's quite easy then to formalize the problem in terms of a test, which is maybe a little bit less complicated than the problem of confidence sets. Is it okay for this story? Okay, so now let's go back to functional estimation. And in fact, what you can prove, and this was done already quite some time ago in 2004 by Kayan Law, what you can prove is that you have no confidence sets for functional inference, so to say, in an infinity norm. No meaning never. I mean, you cannot adapt to anything. And why is that true? Well, if you want to test, you have gamma and alpha. Gamma is larger than alpha, to smoothness. If you want to test between C gamma and C alpha, you can prove that the rate of testing is of order this, which is in fact R1. So the rate of testing in the alternative hypothesis, the rate of estimation, sorry, in the alternative hypothesis, which is always larger than R0. And for non-trivial problem, it's much larger. So it's never possible to do confidence sets in functional estimation and infinity. So this is something which is well known. So this situation, in fact, might seem a little bit paradoxical because you have adaptive inference, you have adaptive estimation, sorry, but you don't have adaptive confidence sets. But in fact, it's very, very common in adaptive inference. For most problems, you have adaptive estimation, but you don't have adaptive confidence sets. And so, in fact, you have really this difference between these two fields. So I can show you here, for instance, some known results, which are not mine again. Some of them are, but mostly not. Which is, so in all these problems, you have adaptive estimation. So density estimation in many norms, functional regression in many norms, sparse regression, extreme value index estimation, or whatever, which are all problems where you have like models of different complexity. You always have adaptive estimation, but you almost, like you don't have confidence sets in general for this problem. You need very weird parameters configurations. You need to know a lot of things about your hyperparameters so that it's possible to adapt. So typically you need to have like a lower bound, for instance, the sparsity example. You need to have a lower bound like on K0 and K1. I mean, you need many stuff. And so, in all generality, it's not possible to do anything. And this notion might look a little bit useless. So, why is this notion interesting? So, before I go to Bendis, I will give you an example where actually you can do adaptive confidence tests. And in this example, I will also highlight a little bit why the notion of adaptive honest confidence test is so subtle. So the slightest change in your modeling assumption make it exist or not. So this problem is in matrix construction. And there, the problem of creating adaptive honest confidence sets is quite subtle. So, okay, so matrix completion. So I hope I don't need to convince you why it is interesting. I think everyone agrees. So this is an example where you have like movies, users, they like or they don't like movies, and you want to try to complete the matrix. And here, rather than just estimating it, I would also be interested in uncertainty quantification. So we want to do inference for the problem of matrix completion. So let me now formalize a little bit mathematically, at least in its simplest form, this problem. In fact, you have two models that are used a little bit indifferently by the community. The first one is trace regression. So you have a matrix F of dimension D times D, let's say that it's quadratic, just to simplify, it doesn't really matter. And you observe yi equal F in xy plus some noise. Let's assume that xi is iid over the entries. This is something that will help me to formalize my results, and that the noise here is bounded, centered, independent, everything. So typically you will observe something like that. So in this model, sometimes you have two observations, and sometimes you have just one, or sometimes you have more, you can have three, four. It's uniform over the matrix. The second model is the Bernoulli model, which is also a broadly used model in the community. And now it's almost the same. The only difference is that, so you have F, yj plus epsilon ij, which you either observe or not. So you observe here a noisy version of the entry ij times a Bernoulli, where the Bernoulli is of parameter n over d squared, so on average you have n samples. It's really, really similar to the other example, just a little bit different in the way that the xi or the BRJ are collected. People use indifferently these two things for estimation. Mostly they use the trace regression model, which is simpler, but this one is maybe a little bit closer to reality, right? So, okay. So in this setting, typically I will be interested in the I-dimensional regime, so d squared larger than n. And of course, it's an ill-posed problem. And so in order to make it well-posed, we need to restrict the set of parameters to something a little bit smaller. And something that people often do for matrix completion is to consider low-rank parameters. So they consider the set of matrix F that have a rank smaller than k and infinity norm smaller than 1. So it's not exactly the same model as the one Sacha mentioned this morning, because here we have the rank constraint, but it's something that people use a lot for matrix completion, at least theoretically. Okay, so now let's ask the question of adaptive inference for matrix completion. So if F is in C of K, morally the rate and the size of the confidence set should depend on K, can we make the inference adaptive to K? So let's first talk about estimation. So in estimation, it's results which are well known since quite some time. What these results say is that the minimax optimal rate for estimating F, an infrobenius norm, is of this order. So it depends on K. This is possible to attain this without knowing K. So you have adaptive estimator. For instance, Panelize. You have a lot of people who have studied various estimators for doing that. And so you have this nice result. And in fact, you have the analysis for this adaptive estimator in both models I mentioned. They are equivalent regarding the rate and also the fact that you have adaptivity. So in terms of estimation of F, not the term, the two models are equivalent. And so now what happens for adaptive and honest confidence sets? Can we have them scaling with K, not R? Sorry. So we have these two models, once again. So let's first start with trace regression. So trace regression, again, you observe Xi uniformly. And what you can prove, and it's something which is quite rare in the domain of adaptive and honest confidence sets, although it's not very, very surprising regarding the model, is that in this model, you have adaptive and honest confidence sets over the entire range of parameters. So you can create confidence sets whose diameter adapt fully to K. And you do, so to two sets, but also to everything. Okay, so it's possible. Morally, the reason why it's possible is that the model reduction is not too radical here. So we are in matrix completion. Even if you are rank one, you have at least d parameters. So the dimension reduction is not too radical between the smaller and the bigger model. This is why it's possible. Okay, so it's nice. At least there you have one model where it's possible. And it's quite rare. We are happy mostly because of that, because it's one of the only models where you really have full adaptive confidence sets over the entire range. Now let's go to the Bernoulli model. So as mentioned, in terms of adaptive estimation, it's equivalent. Now if you look at confidence sets, we have two results. If you know the noise of the data, assume that they are homoelastic, then confidence sets exist. But otherwise, they don't. So if you do this slide, so why did I want to talk about that? It was to mention how, in fact, sensitive the problem of confidence sets is to the model assumptions. So even though adaptive estimation works for both, it's not so sensitive about the model assumption. In this case, it's sensitive.
Noise variance, what do you mean by that here?
Which ones,
if you go back to the model,
epsilon
I, j. The epsilon. B-I-J. You know, epsilon is, well, I mean, it's a subgaussian, it's fine, but it's not.
Sorry?
Yeah, I'm just surprised. It's okay.
I will sketch the proof. Not of the upper bound, but of the other one. very, very quickly. So in this case, if you don't know the variance, you cannot do anything. I will just give a quick sketch, which is, it's not the way we do the proof, but it's a bit the idea. Okay, so let's take a simple example. We want to test H0 random opinions. So morally, F equals 0, and then you have random opinions, versus H1, rank 1 opinion. So here you have pure noise, or at least what I try to make look like pure noise. And here you have a rank 1 matrix. It is rank 1. This is the same vector. This is flipped. This is the same as this one. And this is the same as this one. So it's rank 1. Now we are in the Bernoulli model. So you lose a lot of entries, right? You lose some of them. Now, what are the entries which are interesting for us in order to test versus H0 and H1? So notice that in H0, you have noise, and in H1, you have no noise, right? You don't know what is the variance of the noise if you don't know if you are in H1 or H0. So what are the only data which are interesting here? Well, morally, the only things interesting here are cycles. Everything which is non-cyclic is not interesting because you want to test rank 1, right? So all the other stuff is uninteresting. The only thing that matters is here. You look at the cycle, these two things might be rank 1, and there it's not rank 1. With high probability, if you have a lot of cycles, you will see it's not rank 1. So morally, here, you can count the number of such cycles, and the distinguishability happens only if this number of cycles is larger than 1, so if n is larger than t. This is for rank 1. Now let's go to rank k, and for here k equal 2. So again, you have H0, full noise, H1, rank 2, no noise. Let's take the same scheme. We just keep the cycles, as mentioned before. They look the same. So why is that? Because here, if k is larger than 1, you need more cycles. Because some cycles become non-interesting. This cycle is not interesting. So the correct cycle, or the interesting cycles, you have less than that. You can prove it. And so distinguishability opens only if you have n bigger than that. So then it will depend on k. If it depends on k, it means that the testing rate will depend on k. K is in the biggest model. So you will have the complexity of the biggest model that appears. And so it means that the rate of testing will depend on the bad model. So that's why confidences do not exist. So the proof doesn't go like that at all. It's just an illustration trying to explain a little bit the idea of the proof. OK? So I wrap up for the adaptive inference part. So adaptive inference, while adaptive estimation is often possible in standard models, as I showed you quickly, there are often no adaptive and honest confidence sets. It's mostly impossible to do them. Sometimes it is, though, and sometimes even in interesting models, because sometimes it is in not very interesting regimes. In matrix completion, it's more interesting because it's over the entire range of parameters. But as I have shown you, this is to take with a lot of precautions because this is really dependent on model assumption because it's a testing problem. And testing problems are very sensitive to model. OK, so now let's go to adaptivity in X-arm bandits. I'm going to try to convey a little bit why one can make a parallel between adaptive inference and adaptivity in X-arm bandits. So I go back to the problem. We have a function that we want to either optimize, so find the maximum, or that we want to exploit, which is to say sample as many times as possible high points of the function. And the question, so yeah, as mentioned, there are many people who tackle this problem. What we are going to look at here is morally mostly if we can adapt to the complexity of the problem. So hyperparameters, as mentioned before, we want to adapt, for instance, to the smoothness of the function. So this is formally the X-arm bandit problem. So you have a function f with a max. And for t equal 1 to n, the learner picks a point in the domain, you can choose it now. It receives a noisy version of f at this point. And at the end, so if you are in optimization, you output x of n, which is an estimation of the max. And otherwise, you just count the regret. So how does the game go? You have your function, and you choose a position, and you observe a point. You choose another position, you observe another point, and so on and so forth. Performance measures, in this talk, I will talk about two of them, the simple regret and the cumulative regret. So the simple regret is like the optimization loss, so to say. So it's a difference between m of f and f at the point that you recommend. And the cumulative regret is the difference between what you could have done and what you did in terms of sampling the function. Is it okay for the bandit? Yeah? Okay. So now let's look at assumptions on f. Of course, if you don't put any assumption on f, I mean, you cannot do anything. So let's look at some assumptions. The first assumption that we do is a regularity condition. So it's related to Hölder. So you assume morally that for any 2 points, I mean, it's a bit technical. You can really just replace this by Hölder. Well, not Hölder, but f of x minus f of y smaller than x minus y to the alpha. You can just replace this by that. This is a bit weaker. It's a little bit weaker. And assuming that you are bounded in the max by x minus y to the alpha. Okay. So for a small alpha, you have a very rough function in the maximum. And for a large alpha, you have a smooth function at the max. So morally, this is more difficult than that. Another thing that we do in order to be able to do something with adaptivity is what is called the margin condition, or the Tsibakov noise condition. Anyway, what it means is that if you look at the volume of delta suboptimal points, it's bounded by delta to the beta. So it's just something that tells you that there are not too many points which are delta suboptimal so that you can adapt a little bit. So here are two examples. If you have a small beta, you have not too many optimum, so to say. If you have a large beta, you have a lot of things which are near optimal. So the smaller beta, the more difficult the problem. So this is kind of a standard parametrization for X-arm bandit. Okay, so lower bounds first. So this is not our result. It's a result which I think is in Rubeck et al. 2011, at least for the cumulative regret. But one can deduce things about, well, no, in fact, no. But it's not very difficult to prove that based on the Rubeck et al. Anyway, we do that, but I mean, it's mostly in Rubeck et al. And what you can prove are the following lower bound on the regret. So the best algorithm in the worst case has such performance over the set of functions that are alpha regular and beta margin, so to say. So these are lower bounds on the regret. And so it's, in a minimax sense at least, hopeless to hope to do better than that. Now the question is whether we can do as well as that. So first, let's look at the case where alpha is known. So in this case, in fact, there are many, many works. For instance, for cumulative regrets, the paper by Bubeck et al. 2011. And for simple regrets, the paper by Valco et al. 2015. But also you have the paper by Kleinberg et al. 2008, which was in a slightly different setting, but morally, it's not too different. So you have a lot of strategy. And so morally, the idea, for instance, of optimistic strategy is to use the knowledge of alpha to do confidence bound on the function, and then to refine the partition only in areas which look plausibly to be good, morally. So from one step to the other, you can see it like that. So at time t, you are able, if you know alpha, to do confidence sets around an estimate of your function. It tells you that you have this region which is optimal. You sample it. You sample just here. Don't sample outside. And then you get more refined confidence sets. And this gives you a smaller region which looks suboptimal. And then you sample it. So you keep all the regions such that it could be good. It's like optimistic strategy. So morally, you have the lower bound, so the highest point of the lower bound, which is smaller than the upper bound. So it's very, very classical, so to say. And what you can prove for that, so we do it because we do something a little bit different, we want to find level sets, but morally this was also already kind of known in the literature. Anyway, what you can prove for the regrets, if you just care about simple regrets and adaptive regrets, is the following things. So up to log terms, so now my square with the tilt are constant up to log terms, you have this, if you know alpha, in both cases. But really, this was already kind of known. Okay. Now, what do we see here? So the algorithm needs alpha, it doesn't need beta. So the algorithm adapts to beta, so we don't care about beta. So the only question that remains for us is whether we can adapt to alpha. And as mentioned, here alpha is not exactly the smoothness, but it's something very, very related. So reminder from adaptive inference that we did just before. Adaptive estimation is possible in functional estimation. Functional estimation is the closest inference problem to that. And adaptive and honest confidence set do not exist in functional estimation. And so the question is, I guess, if like our X-arm bandit problem is closer to adaptive estimation or to uncertainty quantification. And then, I mean, if it's closer to the one, it will be possible or not. Let's see. So let's first look at the simple regret. So for the simple regret, in fact, you can adapt to the smoothness. So how do you do? Well, you do something which is really, really, really close to what you do with adaptive inference. So you can do either cross-validation or you can do Lebesgue's method. I will detail a little bit what you do. So here is, for instance, what you do. You take your budget. You split it in log square and chunks of same size. And then you run your algorithm for alpha I equal I over log n. So alpha I goes from 1 over log n to log n, and so to the interesting range. Because if alpha is smaller than 1 over log n, the rate is 1. And if it's bigger, it's a 1 over square root of n. So it's an interesting range here. And then you aggregate the recommendation. I will explain a little bit how afterwards. The idea here is that, so why it will work, is that your true alpha is between, you have it at a precision 1 over log n. So there is at least one of the algorithms which will do well. You don't know which one. If you knew which one, you would get the right regret up to log terms. Here is an example of a run on three different alpha. So if you have a too small alpha, you are going to find an active set at the end, so a set of points where your maximum could be, which is too large, because your confidence sets are going to be too large, morally. But at least it's not wrong. I mean, your maximum is in the set that you have at the end. If you have the right alpha, then just right. And if you have a too small alpha, your algorithm is going to be wrong. So typically, the true maximum is not going to be inside. So how do you aggregate? So you have two strategies, something that was proposed in 2015 in a slightly different context, which is to cross-validate, which is really the simplest thing and most effective thing you can do. So you just evaluate the performance of the strategy on an like independent sample. And the second strategy, which is the one that we did in another context, but also in this context, is to do something close to Lebesgue's method. And so what you do is that you are going to take xn such that these things are coherent. So what do I mean by coherent? So you have here three alpha. Morally, up to this point of alpha, so for all alpha smaller, it's right. I mean, at least xn is in the active set. Here it's completely crazy. So, okay. And it's completely crazy, and so typically it's not going to intersect with this one. Or if it does, then it means that it's not completely crazy. So it's, yeah. Either it intersects for lower level, or it doesn't intersect, and then you know that it's not good. And so what you do is that you aggregate all regions such that, so you take the smallest region such that it's in accordance with all the ones which are in more complex models. So here you just throw away this thing because it's in a simpler model, but it doesn't fit with the more big model. And there you just aggregate the region. So it's kind of logical thing to do. And if you do that, you can prove that you recover the rate adaptively. So here, S, in fact, you can have it really as being 0 to infinity, if beta is bigger than 0. There is a slight subtlety. But morally, okay, it can be any segments, like any closed segments which don't contain zero. If you want to go to zero, you need to look at the interactions between alpha and beta, but okay, it's a subtlety. Okay, let's look now at cumulative regret, and let's look if we can do the same. So as mentioned, simple regret, it's really, really close to adaptive inference, Lepsky's method. Cumulative regret. Okay, so can we first use the method that we propose? Well, we cannot, because we will get a linear regret if we do that. Because, I mean, there are lots of, like, with almost more than n over 2 of the samples, you put it on completely crazy parameters. So can we adaptively balance exploration exploitation in this context? So in fact, what you can prove is that it's impossible. So what can you prove precisely? So this is a result which is quite weaker than what we have in the paper, but it's something that already conveys the flavor of it. So if you have gamma bigger than alpha, and you have a strategy that is near optimal, so you can have some log here or 1 over log, whatever you want. So you have a regret which is bounded by R tilde alpha. So R tilde alpha here is the optimal regret over model alpha. Then, in the smaller model, the regret will be bigger, at least on one example, than the regret alpha. So you don't get gamma here, you get alpha. So what does it mean? It means that you cannot adapt to this model. So it's what we want, morally. Well, it's not what we want, but it's, I mean, it tells what we want to know. So why is it true? So let's go back to inference and to confidence sets. So you have C0, which is P gamma 0, not P gamma beta, but P gamma 0. C1, which is P alpha 0, because in the functional estimation example, beta is equal to 0. And in this setting, you can prove that the test between C0 and C1 has a separation rate of this order. So how do you do that? Well, you construct a test between H0, which is just flat, and H1, which can have some kind of bump anywhere in the domain. So size of the bump depends on alpha. So for instance, this one. And then you compete against all these problems, any of them. And you can prove that you cannot test. So the rate of testing between these two things is this one. So now for bandits. So in our problem, the difference with that is that we have beta, so we need to take care of beta. And also we have adaptive sampling, so we need to prove that even if you have adaptive sampling and not uniform sampling as in the other example, it doesn't work. And so morally, the head of the function that you will get are more like that. So in order to have the beta, you just need to have a small fraction of your set where you put stuff. And you test either a small bump here or some peaks. So for instance, this function. And if you test H0 between all of these functions, even with active, so to say, sampling, you can prove that it's impossible. And so you cannot adapt. Okay. So some remarks to close on this problem. It's not possible in general, but if you have some additional assumptions on your problem, so if the rate is known, which alpha is known, so it's completely silly. But for instance, if M of F is known, so if the maximum is known, then adaptivity is possible. And this mirrors a little bit what you have in adaptive inference. So in adaptive inference, typically, if you have properties on your problems, if you have additional properties, for instance, like monotonicity or stuff like that, adaptive confidence sets start existing. Okay, so I will conclude. So adaptivity for bandits, for continuous bandits, is possible for simple regrets, but not for cumulative regrets. So what does it mean? This is more my interpretation, but simple regret is in a sense closer to adaptive estimation. L2 adaptation is possible. And in fact, the upper bound that we do really looks like what people do with adaptive estimation, because you do some kind of aggregation, Lipsky type, or like cross-validation. And now, for the cumulative regret, it is in essence closer to adaptive and honest confidence sets. And so here, adaptation is impossible. And in fact, the lower bound is very close, again, to what people do for adaptive and honest confidence sets, in order to prove that it doesn't exist. So open problems are to try to systematize this a little bit and to see if one can get a characterization of when it's possible to adapt or not. This would be more like future perspectives. So thank you very much. So it's no, it's I mean the one I know is simple regret. Is it this one?
I think it's in 2015.
So it's for the simple regret. If it's this one, if it's not this
one, they are building on the HO algorithm that they run with different smoothness parameters.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And the analysis of HO is cumulative regret, and I think that.
So this paper, in fact, there are many small problems, to be fair. But the idea is correct. And what they do is they say morally, okay, ITCHO, it works also for the simple regret. And then they aggregate ITCHO, but for the simple regret, not for the cumulative. So it's under slightly different assumptions than what we have. But the idea morally works, but it's for simple regret. It's not for...
So far, people agree... acknowledge that if you solve the cumulative regret, then it can also be good for the simple regret by just recommending one of the points at random.
Yeah, yeah. So it's what they do.
Your new results suggest that you should do two different things, or just that you cannot do anything for regret.
So for cumulative, you cannot adapt at all. You really cannot do anything. For simple regret, you can adapt almost completely, up to lockdowns. But there you cannot really use the aggregation strategy of simple regret. It doesn't make sense for the cumulative. You will get linear regret because it's like, I mean, there are some parts of the budget where you will make crap, morally.
Yeah. So,
thanks so much.
Thank you.